Hello, I'm Jane Thompson and I work for the University and College Union, and we represent researchers working in higher education across the UK. And I've been working there and on anti-casualisation issues for nearly 18 years. In terms of our members, who are, like I say, researchers, postdocs, postgraduates working in universities, there's a huge impact of precarity. We look at the HESA data every year and we're not seeing much movement. We know that 68% of researchers are on fixed term contracts still, that you're more likely to be on a fixed term contract if you're a woman or if you're a person of colour. White men, 29% of white men working in academia are on fixed term contracts in universities, that is. But Asian women, 44% of them are on fixed term contracts. So there's a real equality impact of precarity as well. We've looked at the sort of impact on those people working on those sorts of contracts, most recently in our counting up the cost of casualisation in higher education, which we carried out in 2019. And we had about 4,000 respondents to that survey. There was a majority of those on precarious contracts struggled to manage their budgets, struggled to pay their bills. 83% said it was hard to make long-term plans and to make family plans. And 71% believe their mental health had been affected by the fact that they were on insecure contracts. In terms of research staff specifically, nearly three quarters of them said that they thought the type of contract they were on had negatively impacted on the research they were carrying out. Over 80% of them said that being on insecure contracts actually affected their own research activity. Only 6% when asked thought that the way that we currently employ research staff on this sort of endemic fixed term contracts was a cost effective way of employing researchers and a good way for research. And a whopping 96% said that they thought that more secure contracts would lead to genuinely innovative research. So certainly the view of the researchers on these contracts is these contracts are stifling research. Most wanted a secure teaching and research contract. There's also been research on the dehumanising impact of casualisation. And there was a report by Nick McGoran and Olivia Mason from Newcastle back in 2020, which looked at how that being on those sorts of contracts made people feel. And the Wellcome Trust report that came out in January 2020 noted the widespread concerns about job insecurities and concluded that led to little confidence in researchers in pursuing a research career. And just lastly, we know that power imbalances are one of the reasons that bullying and harassment goes on, that people feel scared to speak up. And when you have an endemic casualized workforce, that is, multiplied and magnified. So that we keep talking about this culture of bullying and harassment amongst research, and the researchers are scared. Part of that is because they're on insecure contracts. So overall, it has a massively negative impact on both researchers themselves and on the research they produce. I think there are a number of agents who are responsible for where we are at the moment. And we know this isn't new. I think there's a responsibility on government that they've moved funding away from secure funding to universities to much more competitive grant funding. So there's much more insecurity around the funding streams for research. We know they've underfunded the sector, full stop. And I think the marketisation of HE, which has been pursued by this government and previous governments, is also an issue in that people are seen as a resource to hire and fire at will, rather than a sort of part of an academic team that makes a university. So I think the government, there absolutely is a responsibility there. I think the funders have responsibility. Their move to shorter term contracts, shorter term funding has been a problem. And actually they could quite easily just say, the funding is here for 5 years, 10 years, rather than a year, 2 years. I don't think the funders pay enough scrutiny to employers and how they're employing research staff. We're encouraging employers to sign up to the Concordat, for example, but we're not asking for concrete examples of how the Concordat is implemented and monitoring how institutions are moving away from insecure contracts. And I think funders have a role in doing that. But mostly I think the responsibility lays with the employers. They are responsible for the employment of research, however they get the money in. And let's just remember, they are not unique in that. They are not unique in being an institution that gets money from various funding streams, some of which comes in fits and starts. And whilst funding streams do come and go, funding for particular projects comes and goes, the overall funding for research is pretty steady. So it's not, it just disappears from year to year. It's just that individual projects stop. And I can't think of anywhere else where our response to that is to employ individuals on fixed term contracts purely for the duration of that funding. They don't need to use fixed term contracts in this way. And whilst the overall figure is, you know, 68%, because those are the HESA figures for 2018-19, there is a huge variance amongst different institutions of using fixed term contracts. Or Exeter, who still use 87% of their research staff on fixed term contracts, Leeds it's down to 64%, Bristol 23%, and UCL 5%. Now they're all research intensive universities, all pre-92s, yet they have a very, very different way of employing staff. Why are we treating this group differently? There hasn't been, overall, there hasn't been a mass shift in the reduction of fixed term contracts since the fixed term regulations came in. We did see a drop from sort of 80 odd percent to the sort of static figure of the late 60s we're seeing now. But I don't really understand why we treat this group differently. The other thing that universities have done is in the expansion of higher education, which has seen a 23% increase in the number of staff. It's like 26% increase in number of academic staff working at university. Universities have chosen to mostly use that money to fund the types of contracts that are more likely to be insecure, so teaching only and research only funding. And we're now at a position where the majority of academic posts are not these classic lecturing posts. They're actually teaching only and research only. They make up a bigger proportion of academic posts. And that's a decision that has been made by the employers. So they are cutting the route to permanent contracts for people on insecure contracts. And how they use their money and how they employ people is within their gift. And I think, you know, we have got examples where employers are doing better. So we know it's possible. So I think really the ball is in their court to do more. I think there needs to be a recognition that we're not doing enough and not enough is being done. I don't think the employers collectively have recognised that. In fact, UCEA keep putting out things denying there's a problem. But actually at the current rate of change, although there has been a slight, you know, 1% here, 1% there, drops in the rates of fixed term contract use for researchers, my own analysis shows it will take over 200 years for us to get to a position where only one in 20 researchers will have a fixed term contract. So we have to speed that up if we really want to have a sustainable research workforce. I think the government could make more core funding available for research, that would help. That research funders could insist on employers using open-end contracts and to support more secure employment, because it's not just a matter of shifting from fixed term contracts to open-end contracts with a at-risk date, which is many employers have done. I think those of us overseeing the Research Concordat should be requiring evidence for signatories that they have signed up to that principle of moving away from endemic fixed-term contracts to more secure employment, and be asking to see evidence of that moving. There needs to be targets in there that they are moving away from the endemic use of fixed-term and insecure contracts, whatever they're called. And we need to be able to measure that. I think them just saying, oh, we're talking about a policy or ticking a box isn't enough. We need to be saying, you need to reduce it by this much by this date. I think institutions need to commit to working with UCU to make improvements. So like I say, where institutions do work with us, we do see improvements. Employers need to commit to reducing the use of fixed term contracts. They need to make that commitment. They need to support things like redeployment between projects, making sure that they're okay with things like bridging funds. And that's just an accountancy issue. You know, if you know money's coming in for another project in a month's time, just make that money available to keep someone in post so they can move from project to project. We do it in all sorts of other areas of work. We just don't do it in research. But mostly I think we need to change this perception that research is somehow special and fixed term contracts are the norm, and it's what we do and it's how we run things and it's a stepping stone to a secure contract. None of those things are true or have to be true. And Why can't we have research pools? We've talked about it for years and years and years. And we've got very, very small pockets of good practice out there. We haven't got a single institution who's grasped that pistol and just gone, okay, we're going to do it. I'd really, really like to see someone or a few institutions step forward and say, we are willing to give this a go. Let's see how it works. Let's see what happens. Let's work with UCU locally and nationally. So, you know, to get this off the ground and just start taking researchers like everybody else. Universities who are committed to challenging this and to do something about it need to put pressure on other universities who aren't, and they need to put pressure through UCIA to get some movement there. At the moment, UCIA won't talk to us about any of this, so they need to use their power to do that. And I think our part of our campaign of recognising PGRs as staff, now if we saw PGRs as the first place in a research career, then I think that starts to sort of say the next step, the postdoc career, we've got to have something better in place rather than just another decade of fixed term contracts for people who choose to move into academia following their postgraduate, their doctorate. We've been trying for a very, very long time, and certainly I've seen records going back to the 60s at least, where we've had research groups in what was then AUT, became UCU, challenging the use of fixed-term contracts. So we've been working on this for a very, very long time. And like I say, I've been there for 18 years and worked on anti-cash campaigns ever since that time. I mean, I think that where we've got the most success is where we have managed to work, or our branches have managed to work with individual institutions to negotiate policies that commit to the reduction in the use of fixed-term contracts. So that's our sort of a big focus for us. So when that happens, we publicise it and we share good practice, both within the UK and internationally. On the other side of that, we do a lot of work highlighting the very poor practice that a lot of universities employ, and trying to get people to understand the extent of the problem. I think people think of Uber drivers, they think of, you know, muck jobs, as they're known, you know, the gig economy, and very few people think, you know, university research is up there in one of the most casualised sectors of the UK. We put reducing casualisation, and particularly around reducing fixed term contracts, in our national claim to the employers every year. We do lobby government and funders and employment bodies about this, and you know, we raise it at every opportunity. We do input into forums, into discussions on research. We try and talk to UKRI. We're part of the Concord Strategy Group. And we liaise across the UK and internationally with other bodies who are doing that. And like I said, we've launched our PGRs as staff campaign, which we hopefully will sort of help to get this sort of what does a research career look like sort of much more into the open, so we can have that debate. So we will continue to do all those things, but we can't do that alone. I mean, we're restricted in what we can do. You know, we need the employers to be willing to discuss this. And until and unless they do, it's very, very difficult for us. We've obviously got very, very good branches across the UK, some of whom have managed to negotiate better conditions. But there are competing priorities for those branches. You know, we had COVID, we have redundancies, we have workload. So it's very, very difficult for us to, you know, focus on a campaign around researchers and reducing casualisation. Many branches have done that, don't get me wrong, and have been brilliant in doing that. But, you know, we are limited in that when nationally the employers won't talk to us. We've got limited power to exert pressure on this government, particularly this government. And so I said, like I say, you know, we will continue to fight it. But I think unless nationally something is done, we are relying on local branches, of which we have something like 167 and I think something like that in higher education. We're expecting each of them to prioritise this and do that. And that's a very, very big ask. And we're also expecting individual employers to prioritise it and sit around the table. This isn't an easy fix. We know it's something that will take time to resolve. And it would be a lot better resolved if nationally the employers would talk to us and they would set minimum standards that they expect all universities to follow. We could actually then work a lot more easily at a local level to get improvements.